الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا أشهد أن نبينا ومولانا محمد عبده ورسوله أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وما آتاكم الرسول فخذوه وما نهاكم عنه فانتهوا صدق الله العظيم عن ابن عمر رضي الله تعالى عنهما قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا أنزل الله بقوم عذابا أصاب العذاب من كان فيهم ثم بعثوا على أعمالهم صدق الله العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الكريم ونحن على ذلك من الشاهدين والشاكرين سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي دروشے پڑھنا ہے Respected brothers, respected elders, mothers and sisters listening at home. We are living in an age which is basically a countdown for the coming of the main events. Already we have seen many, many prophecies of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to be fulfilled. A lot of questions that are asked, especially to the scholars. One question that was posed to me also was that, how long have we got left until the last day, the day of Qiyamah? The answer is very simple. That the day of Qiyamah is very, very close. There is no time. We are very, very close to the day of what is mentioned in Surah Al-Fatiha, Maliki Yawmiddin. Yawmiddin, the day when everyone will be accounted for all the actions they committed. Why? Every information that is given to us comes from Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Aap sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was blessed with divine knowledge. Divine knowledge. Aap sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has mentioned in one hadith that the waiting period for my ummah until the day of Qiyamah is approximately the time between Asr and Maghrib. Asr and Maghrib. Perhaps the shortest period of time between two salats, when you want to combine the two namazis together, would be Asr and Maghrib. A lot of the brothers, after performing Asr Salah, they stay over and recite the Quran until Maghrib Salah. One of the proof, one of the dalil of Fiqh Hanfiya, that Asr Salat should be prayed slightly late. If you go to Saudi, the time is different. But one of the dalil is because of that, mentioned in the hadith. The waiting period is equivalent to the time that we spend in the masjid from Asr to Maghrib. From Fajr to Zuhr, the waiting period is long. From Isha to Fajr, even longer. Even from Zuhr to Asr, the waiting period is long. Maghrib to Isha also is quite a long time. But the shortest is Asr to Maghrib. Aap sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, the time given to my ummah before the day of Qiyamah is equivalent to the time that he spends when he performs Asr and he waits for Maghrib Salah. So the fact is, when you look at the ahadith of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we are very, very close to the day of Qiyamah. A lot of people think, oh, Imam Mahdi, he'll come, we've still got a lot of time. In fact, some of them speak about Imam Mahdi as if there is this doubt, an element of doubt. Allahu Akbar. Even Muslims, even Dajjal, even Yajuj and Majuj. It's not far at all. The time is very, very close. Aap sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a hadith has mentioned, Bu'ithtu أنا والساعتو كهاتين. And this is what he did. The index finger and the middle finger. And he said, I am here. And the time left for the day of Qiyamah is that little, the short space that you see here. Between the two fingers. Middle and index finger. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I myself am one of the signs of Qiyamah. I am Khatamun Nabiyeen, there is no prophet after me. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave so much explanation to the ummah, to the companions, and we receive all the knowledge through Ashabi Kiram. On one occasion, Hazrat Abu Zaid radiallahu ta'ala, especially the signs of Qiyamah, he is the narrator of the hadith. He says that after Fajr Salat, all of a sudden, Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sat on the mimbar. That is not his tarteeb, not his sunnah. The sunnah of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has always been that after Fajr Salah, he would look at the companions. And he would ask the companions, have any of you seen any dreams? Have any of you seen any dreams? That is the sunnah mentioned in the hadith. Or, if nobody had seen any dreams, if Aap sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had seen some vision, Aap sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, all the dreams that come to the Prophet are wahi. It's the revelation, one type of revelation. Aap sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would explain that dream to the companions. But Hazrat Abu Zaid says that all of a sudden, Aap sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told all of us to come close to the mimbar. And Huzur alayhi salatu wa sallam sat on the mimbar. And he gave us a khutbah, a bayan, khutbah as in a bayan, explaining to us the signs of Qiyamah. He explained to us every single sign, all the events that are to unfold before the last hour, before the day of Qiyamah. Everything was explained. He sat after Fajr on the mimbar until it was Zuhr time. Can you imagine that, my respected brothers? Can any of the Imams do that here? Probably get sacked. If the Imam takes about 25, 30 minutes, or even 35 minutes on a Friday, Mali Sahab, dhando chek any, tamaru ho kamcha, maru kamcha. Every time the Imam, when he sits on the mimbar, he's pressured looking at the time, and for Juma especially, quarter past one, the entire topic, subject, he has to explain everything and fit everything in that, in the very short time that he has, 20, 25 minutes. A lot of people say, then why don't you start early? If we start early, do we talk to the jinns? Who do we speak to? To the jinns? Against bayan to them, people were prepared to come at 12:30. Alhamdulillah, we can do a bayan, start a bayan at 12:15. If brothers can promise us that all of us will come, inshallah ta'ala, we will come, then we can start the bayan at 12:15, even 12:30. But the tarteeb in Leicester, and in fact in all the masajid, is that the bayan would start at 10:00. Brothers would still be downstairs talking to each other, kamcho, orache, everything, making salam, kalam, and coming slowly upstairs. It's about 1:05 when we see the front surf, the first, second saf starting to get filled up. In fact, today I saw someone, I noticed at approximately 1:15, he managed to creep into the front saf. The subjects we want to hear is something that is not normal, something intriguing. Signs of Qiyamah is something very nice. But if it was just a basic topic, we've heard all that. Some people have that habit. You start something and they say, oh, we've heard that. It's not about hearing, my respected brothers. It's about putting it into practice. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, give me the tawfiq. I am a sinner, a weak person. By the barakat of the people that are sitting here, Allah forgive my sins. Who am I? Allahu Akbar. Subhanallah al-Azim. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala judges. I'm just sitting here and explaining to you the words of the greatest person, Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Like a tape recorder, my respected brothers. If you have a tape here, play it. Subhanallah. We have to make an effort. We have to make an effort. We must have that talab. And the scholars were there, Hazrat Maulana Shah Ismail Shaheed. I'm not going away from my topic. Great speaker in India. When people knew that he was to deliver a khutbah in Pakistan, thousands and thousands of people would come. The bayan day would start after Isha until Fajr. That is the best time suitable for everyone. There is no namaz in the middle. Isha until Fajr. On the stage, the Imam would be there, Sheikh Shah Ismail Shaheed would be there. Come to Islamabad, Punjab, it's a long distance. When he got there, the bayan was finished. And he said to people, where is Maulana Shah Ismail Shaheed Sahib? Where is Maulana Shah Ismail Shaheed Sahib? Apparently what had happened is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala works mysteriously. He was actually speaking to Maulana Shah Sahib. That where is Maulana Shah Sahib? And Shah Sahib is saying to him that why are you asking about Maulana Shah Ismail Shaheed? He says, oh, I came all the way from Karachi to hear his bayan. I am his ashik. And I have missed his bayan. So Maulana Shah Sahib's bayan, 3 hours, 4 hours. He says, you want to listen to Maulana Shah Sahib's bayan? He says, yes, I came with ikhlas from Karachi to hear him. He says, you have the energy? He says, yes. He says, okay, sit here. Sit on the side. Maulana Shah Sahib, word to word, for that one single brother, 3 hours, same bayan. He says, you haven't missed anything. I am Shah Ismail Shaheed. These are the brothers. So here are people there, alhamdulillah, subhanallah al-azim. Everything is different. These are great people, great buzrugani deen, who worked. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all the tawfiq, the signs of qiyamah. Our sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did a khutbah from Fajr to Zuhr. After Zuhr, he sat on the minbar again started to explain the signs of Qiyamah until Asr. All the companions were sitting. After Asr again, sat on the minbar explaining the signs of Qiyamah until Maghrib Salah. After Maghrib, he gave permission to the companions that now you can go home. Every single Sahabi was sitting in front of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with great respect. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explained to them every event that was to take place. All the signs, major and minor. Just in one day, from Fajr until Maghrib Salah. So that is why, as Muslims, as believers, the people of the Kalima, it is extremely important that we have Iman and we also listen attentively and Alhamdulillah also prepare ourselves for the major events that are to come our way in the future. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all the tawfiq. Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the hadith, that amsi khayrun min al-yawm. One of the signs of Qiyamah, Hazrat is saying, yesterday is better than today. Then our sallallahu alayhi wa sallam carried on, he said that wal-yawmu khayrun min ghadin. And today is better than tomorrow. Or in another words, the past is better than the present, or the present is better than the future. Indicating to us that every day, as we get close to the day of Qiyamah, more and more fitna will be exposed, more and more fitna will come, more and more fitna will come. Subhanallah al-Azim. Allahu Akbar. That is why some of the Akabideen had the habit that they would eat the rotis that were cooked 2 days ago, 1 day ago. They would never eat fresh rotis. I'm not saying that is taqwa, that we stop eating rotis. No. Some of the Akabideen, some of the Buzruganideen, that was their habit. They would say it is closer to the time of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they would eat that roti. That was their habit. They were Akabideen, they had that taqwa. Subhanallah. Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said in the hadith, إِنَّ لِكُلِّ أُمَّةٍ فِتْنَةٌ وَفِتْنَةُ أُمَّةِ الْمَالِ. Every community, every ummah that came in this world, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested them. Fitna touched them. Fitna means imtihan, not the Urdu fitna. That is why it's very, very important that we understand the Arabic language. Fitna in Urdu is different. Fitna in the Arabic language is different. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِنَّمَا أَمْوَالُكُمْ وَأَوْلَادُكُمْ فِتْنَةٌ. Your children are fitna. But it is not the Urdu version of fitna. It is the Arabic version of fitna. The children are also a form of examination for the parents. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests the ummah. Our sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the fitna, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will test the ummah, wa fitnatu ummati al-mal, in the wealth that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us. Allah will test us all. That is why near the day of Qiyamah, one of the signs is that fuzul kharchi, squandering with money. Squandering with money. Fuzuliyat. Everything that you see. Buying things that are unnecessary. إِنَّ الْمُبَذِّرِينَ كَانُوا إِخْوَانَ الشَّيَاطِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, the one who wastes money, he is the brother of shaitan. And the cancer of the ummah today is that for money, he will exchange important information. That is the cancer of the ummah of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Palestinian brothers given money. So, you give us information, money. Once you give them a lot of money, someone who has never seen money, and then you show him money, that this is all yours. This is your palace, this is your house, this is your bank balance. Allahu Akbar Kabir. That is why exactly what Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, wa fitnatu ummati al-mal. The fitna of my ummah is wealth. Allah judges a person by the money that is given to him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq. That is why alhamdulillah, giving charity, giving those people who are in need of money, alhamdulillah, this is good akhlaq. This is good nature inside a Muslim. Hazrat Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said in the hadith, one of the signs of Qiyamah is that إِذَا مَشَّتْ أُمَّتِي الْمَطِيطَ أو كَمَا قَالَ لَهِ صَلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ, that my followers will become arrogant. The believers will become arrogant people. They will become متكبرين. They will take pride. That is why in the hadith of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam it is mentioned that one of the signs of Qiyamah is that salam will be the first thing that will vanish away. Some people will cross the road in order to avoid that Muslim brother who is coming. You have to make salam to him. Oh, and that is a burden. So the easiest way out is to cross the road. So you don't need to make salam. Oh, with great burden, just put your gaze down so you avoid him and you don't make salam. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said that. One of the signs of Qiyamah, no salam. The system of Islamic greeting will go away. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has mentioned in a hadith narrated by Hazrat Abdullah ibn Masud that La tazula qadamai ibn Adam yawm al-qiyamati hatta yus'al an khamsin aw kama qala alayhi salatu wa salam, to even move to the limit of one step until five questions are put forward to him. An umrihi, about his age. Wa an shababihi, about his youth. The youth, the young age that Allah gave him. How did you spend your young days? Wa an malihi, and again coming back to the wealth. Min ayna iktasabahu, how did you acquire it? Wa fima anfakahu, and where did you spend it? Wa maza amila za alima aw kama qala alayhi salatu wa salam, and how much did you put into practice the knowledge, the information that you had, whatever you knew, did you put that into practice? These are the signs of qiyamah. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, near the day of qiyamah, Huzur alayhi salatu wa salam said, rubba kasiyatun kasiyatin aariyatun fil akhirah. Many women that dress up in this world will be completely naked in the hereafter. Rubba kasiyatin fi dunya aariyatun fil akhirah. Aw kama qala alayhi salatu wa salam. Why? That is why we have to respect our Muslim sisters and mothers, that even when it's a hot day, very, very hot, subhanallah, they wear burqa and they cover the face and walk. They honor the beauty. They honor the respect that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them. Subhanallah. What is the heat of this dunya compared to the heat of Jahannam? The fire. It is very easy for a Muslim woman to take out her scarf and to wear clothes that are tight. Exactly what Huzur alayhi salatu wa salam has said. On the day of Qiyamah, they will go to Jahannam. Why? Because the clothes that they were wearing in dunya was not with ikhlas, it was a form of display. The clothes they were wearing was for display. So when they walk on the road, they would take pride when all sorts of ghair mahram would look at them. And the more men look at them, the shaitan whispers in the heart that, oh, you see, you are very, very beautiful. Every person that is walking is looking at you. Extreme. And unfortunately, the men have become also so weak. So weak. Maulana Ibrahim Madani Sahib, when he did a bayan, few days ago, he said that some of the professors in the English language were talking about tafsir and Quran. The translation, can we do the translation of the Quran? Mala Ibrahim Madani said to them that, give me the translation of ghairat. Ghairat. Kya? Ghairat. Because ghairat is not in that community. So how will you give a translation? What word will you use? Because gharat is not there. Shame is not the right word. It hasn't got that meaning which gharat has. And Maulana gave a beautiful example. He said, what is gharat? Gharat is that when a man is walking with his wife, he would have haya, that how can anyone see my wife? Gharat ay. In the hadith it comes that when Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, when he saw a dream, he saw this beautiful palace. And he saw the Hur, Hurayin, making wuzu. Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam decided that let me go and enter this palace, this Jannat. And then all of a sudden, Huzur alayhi salatu wasalam changed his mind, because the companion said to him that this palace belongs to Hazrat Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala. And he changed his mind, thinking of the ghairat
the hayat that Hazrat Umar Farooq had, that how can I enter when the hoor of Hazrat Umar Farooq are inside? So Rasulullah alayhi wa sallam turned away. When this was related to Hazrat Umar Farooq, Hazrat Umar Farooq started to cry. He says, Ya Rasulullah, would I have ghairat from you? How nice it would have been that if you entered the palace. That is why, my respected brothers, parda is ni'mah. Parda saves marriages. Parda is the cure to the sickness that is prevalent, which is divorce, talaq, parda. Subhanallah al-Azim. Parda is the greatest ni'mah. A lot of people say, make your heart clean before you have a beard. Make your heart clean before you wear an ababa. Make your heart clean. We are making our heart clean. That is the way to make your heart clean. That is the way. One day it will help you. Unfortunately, my respected brothers, even in the Arab countries, some of, if you go to even Palestine, no exception, Muslim Arab ladies wearing skirts, not realizing that the legs are visible. Parda should be like in Saudi Arabia when we go for Hajj and Umrah, we see the burqa covering the whole body. That is parda. And that is what is meant. Huzur alayhi salatu wa salam has said, no offense to the mothers and sisters listening at home. I'm not putting it in a strong way. These are the words of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ariyatun fil akhirah. On the day of Qiyamah, they will be completely naked because the dressing code was, it was all tight, the clothes were tight, the body parts were exposed. And it was in an invitation to all the ghair mahrams. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us all the tawfiq. Many, many signs, my respected brothers, mentioned in the hadith of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the two major signs, Dajjal and Yajuj and Majuj. Dajjal is a fitna that affects every human being on an individual level. It is one man. The fitna comes from one side, one individual. After that, Yajuj and Majuj. Yajuj, Majuj, the fitna of Yajuj and Majuj is at a collective level. It affects everyone. And Gog and Magog, Yajuj and Majuj is not 1, 2, 3 millions, if not billions, even billions. In the hadith, Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, 999 who will go to Jahannam will be from Alu Yajuj and Majuj, one will be from my ummah. Imagine how many they will be in numbers. It will be a collective fitna. Hazrat Isa alayhi salatu wa salam will, the true Masih, will kill the false Masih, Masihud Dajjal. Once Dajjal is dead, Allahu Akbar, the world will be invaded by godless, fearless, and most powerful people. Very, very powerful. Even Zulkarnain, being the superpower at that time, did not say to the people around him that I have the power to take on these people and to suppress Yajuj and Majuj. He said, no, I will build and seal them for you. When Yajuj and Majuj come, the Quran says, فَإِذَا جَاءَ وَعَدُ الْحَقِّ فَإِذَا جَاءَ وَعَدُ رَبِّي جَعَلَهُ دَكَّى. When the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will come, the wall of Yajuj and Majuj will become dakka. Dakka means powder. The wall of Yajuj and Majuj will become dakka powder. And at that time, every single one. We have heard stories that Yajuj and Majuj are licking the wall, licking the wall, licking the wall. Until one day someone will say, Inshallah, tomorrow we will penetrate. Again, the authenticity of that, Wallahu alam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. There are some stories mentioned in the hadith. But the fact is that they are sealed in that area. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will want them to come out, that is the promise in the Quran. Allah says, جَعَلَهُ دَكَّا, the wall will come down, it will collapse. وَكَانَ وَعَدُ رَبِّي حَقَّا, and the promise subhanahu wa ta'ala is all true. In Surah Al-Anbiya, Allah says, حَتَّى إِذَا فُتِحَتْ يَأْجُوجُ وَمَأْجُوجُ, until when Ya'juj and Ma'juj break through the barrier, وَهُمْ مِنْ كُلِّ حَدَبٍ يَنْسِلُونَ. Subhanallah, they will swarm down from every height. Jitni bhi bulandi hogi, anything, any hilltop, any mountain, the only thing you will see is Ya'juj and Ma'juj coming out, Ya'juj and Ma'juj coming out, Ya'juj and Ma'juj coming out. Non-stop Ya'juj and Ma'juj will come out. Wherever you see, they will basically, my respected brothers and elders, invade the world. They will take over. No army in the world will have the power to suppress them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has described them in the Quran to be mufsiduna fil ard. They will be agents of fasad. Agents of fasad. What is fasad? Awesome oppression. Awesome corruption. If you look at the Quran, the same word fasad is also used to describe the Jews. وَقَضَيْنَا إِلَىٰ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ فِي الْكِتَابِ لَتُفْسِدُنَّ فِي الْأَرْضِ. The word fasad is also used for them. And the word fasad is also used for Ya'juj and Ma'juj. قَالُوا يَا ذَلْقَرْنَيْنِ إِنَّ يَعْجُوجَ وَمَعْجُوجَ مُفْسِدُونَ فِي الْأَرْضِ. The same word is used for them. What is fasad? A man steals a car, robs a bank with it, and then he wants to dump the car somewhere in the suburb. Mission accomplished. Then you get another person, steals the car, robs the bank. He had a choice, could just park the car somewhere, but no. He burns out the car, destroys the car totally. That is fasad. And that will be their mission. They will eat away everything, and they will drink everything. That is why the ulama have mentioned that wasting of water is one of the signs of Ya'juj and Ma'juj. Some of the scholars did not like the system of taps. They did not like that. Why? Because in the system of taps, we are missing out some of the sunnah of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Our sallallahu alayhi wasallam would scoop through whatever it was, a bartan, a bowl at that time, and he would make wuzu in that manner. So when you have a tap system, the water is always running, always running. And that is why water is being wasted. So some of the ulama did not like that system. I'm not saying it's haram, not jais. No, alhamdulillah, we have it in the masajid. When the Dajjal will be killed, the only area for the Muslims as a sanctuary, as a refuge, will be the mountains. Muslims will hide away in the mountains. The city will be occupied by Ya'juj and Ma'juj and those who follow the system of Ya'juj and Ma'juj. One by one the Muslim will get out, go away in the jungle, climb the mountains. At that time, Hazrat Isa alayhi salatu wassalam will be on the mountain of Tur with the majority of the Muslims with him in that area, in that location. The name of Tur is there because that is exactly where Hazrat Isa alayhi salatu wassalam will be. And the other Muslims will be taking refuge inside some of the mountains there. Mountains and Muslims have great connection. The first revelation, Ghare Hira. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wahi started on a Mount Ghara Hira. The khutbah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he gave at Hajj near the Jabal of Arafat mountain. When sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made hijrah, he took refuge in a cave, Ghara Thawr, Allahu Akbar. And there is peace and tranquility. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam talked about Ghara Uhud, the mountain of Uhud. Jabalun yuhibbuna wa nuhibbuhu. It is a mountain that the mountain loves me and I love that mountain. All the Muslims at that time will be with Hazrat Isa alayhi salatu wa salam, and Ya'juj and Ma'juj will come after Hazrat Isa alayhi salatu wa salam, beseeching that finkeldom to come out. There is no power to fight Ya'juj and Ma'juj. At that time, Hazrat Isa alayhi salatu wa salam will lift his hand, the believers will be there, saying Ameen to the dua of Hazrat Isa alayhi salatu wa salam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will accept his dua. It will be a bad dua. It will be a dua against Ya'juj and Ma'juj. Subhanallah. Look at the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is said that little insects will come and attack every god. No army in the world can destroy Ya'juj and Ma'juj. But the army of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, little insects will come and bite every single Gog and Magog on the neck. Instantly they will die. Everything that is inside will come out. Allahu Akbar. And once the Muslims will see it safe, that there is no more Ya'juj and Ma'juj, slowly Hazrat Isa alayhi salatu wa salam will come down. At that time it is said that Hazrat will not, or the Muslims also at that time, they won't have space even to move to the level of one step, one span. In the hadith it comes, wherever you see it will be the bodies of Ya'juj and Ma'juj, Ya'juj and Ma'juj. Blood will be there. Hazrat Isa alayhi salatu wa salam's second dua will be, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will purify the earth. It is said that Allah will send birds not here, birds that humans have never ever seen, another makhluk of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, very very strong. In the hadith it comes that they will have necks like Bakhtirian camels, strong necks. They will come and they will pick up the bodies of Ya'juj and Ma'juj, Ya'juj and Ma'juj. In the hadith, there is no mentioning of where the bodies will be disposed. So the translator, Allah wills. And so there will be no more Ya'juj and Ma'juj. And finally, at that time, it will rain and the world will be purified again. After that, alhamdulillah, everything will grow normally. And alhamdulillah, everybody will be with Hazrat Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. That will be the end of Ya'juj and Ma'juj and Dajjal. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all the tawfiq. Inshallah, next week we can talk on the subject of what Isa alayhi salatu wasalam will do when he performs his Hajj, when he gets married, he'll have children. And also after that, other signs that follow up to the day of Qiyamah. How will the last day come? One of the signs of Qiyamah is also Dabbatul Ard, the beast that will come out. That is mentioned also in the Quran. Inshallah ta'ala, if Allah wills, we can continue with the subject next week. Wa akhiru da'wana and alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa salatu wa salamu ala sayyidil mursaleen. لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك إنا كنا من الظالمين اللهم إنا نسألك العفو والعافية في الدنيا والآخرة سبحان الله وبحمده سبحان الله العظيم اللهم لا تدع لنا ذنبا إلا غفرته ولا هما إلا فرجته ولا دينا إلا قضيته ولا حاجة من حوائج الدنيا والآخرة إلا قضيتها وصلى الله تعالى على خير خلقه محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه وأزواجه وذرياته وأهل بيته أجمعين برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين.